2014, and I'll call the meeting to order. First order of business is to elect a chair.
I'd like to nominate Gary Katz as the chair.
Second.
Just point of order, we don't need seconds for nominations. Okay. We just need another round of nominations.
I have to say, is there anybody else?
Oh, discussion or anybody else? Anything?
I nominate Michael Fitzpatrick.
No, thanks. I'm not interested in that part, no.
Is there anything else? Thank you. Hearing none. All those in favor of Gary Katz?
Aye.
Aye. Not hearing me over
here. All those opposed?
No.
Okay, Gary, take it away.
Was that three to one with one abstention?
Yes, that okay. Is. And take it away before I mess it up in your bed.
Okay. We need to elect the vice chair. Any nominations?
I nominate Todd.
Got a nomination for Todd? Mm-hmm. Any other nominations? Discussion? All in favor of having Todd serve? You're okay with that?
Yeah.
All in favor of having Todd serve as vice chair, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions?
I'm going to abstain. I'll abstain.
Carries. Now have to elect the clerk.
Nominate Shannon Bethel.
Second.
Any other nominations?
Not for nominations.
Shannon, are you okay with that?
Okay.
No, you're shaking your head.
Yes, that's right.
Okay, you're scaring me first of all. Okay. Any discussion? All in favor of appointing Shannon as the town clerk, please say aye.
No, not the town clerk.
I'm sorry. The administrative assistant. Did I read this wrong? Is this supposed to be the administrative assistant?
No, it's the clerk of the board.
Oh, I'm sorry. Board,
yeah.
Okay. So clerk of the board.
Yeah.
You're still okay with that?
Yes.
And you'll still be the administrative assistant?
Yes, but not
but you
the
won't
town
be
clerk.
The town clerk.
Yes.
Okay, good. All in favor of Shannon as clerk to the board, please say aye.
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 Opposed? Abstentions? Okay, we're good. Thank you. Next on business is to set the meeting schedule, the date, location, and time of regular select board meetings. Are they still the first and third Thursday?
6:30.
Is that still good with everybody?
Yes.
Fine with me.
Do we need a motion or just sense of the board is enough?
The sense of the board, I think, is good.
Okay. Anybody object to that? All right. First and third Thursdays at 6:30. Board of Health and local Board of Liquor Control, usually on an as-needed basis. That's still okay with everybody?
We are the Board of Liquor Control.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah. But we have meetings as necessary. Okay?
And we have several liquor licenses that have been returned. I'm going to wait until they're all returned, then I'll let people know when we need to schedule.
Okay, sounds good. Liquor control. Alrighty, that's it on meeting schedule. Location for posting of notices and minutes. What have we been doing recently?
Here, the New Fane Market, WW Building Supply, the Williamsville Hall when it's open, so in the winter we don't, and then the South New Fane Williamsville Post Office.
Okay, mm-hmm. Does that seem to have been serving the purpose?
Yep.
Everybody
still
okay with that? Okay, there are a lot of heads nodding, so we'll go ahead with those same locations. Item number five, official newspaper for posting of notices and advertisements. Let's go using the reformer.
Dalbo reformer.
Okay. Everyone's okay with that?
Yeah.
Yes.
All right. Appointments. We need to appoint the road commissioner. I should tell you that. Go ahead.
Do you have an old agenda? I put a new one in the boxes.
I'm sorry, we won't go to appointments. Go to scheduled members of the public. Has Ken come in yet? Okay, so we'll wait for him. Ken McFadden comes in, so Deb Luskin.
Hi. I'm just curious about, tell you what I came for. The location and notice of minutes, can we also have them online? Can they also be posted online?
Yeah.
Every other week basis? Or whenever?
Yeah, I mean, I'm really done by Tuesday afternoon before the meeting, so.
Yeah. Well, but if you can see them online, that would be awesome.
Yeah.
Great.
Do you see a problem?
No, just a question. When she puts them online just before the meeting, that would be a draft. We'd have to have them approved, and then she would upload them.
So what usually gets posted in the post office?
Oh, the agenda.
The agenda.
The agenda.
Just the agenda.
Okay. Well, the minutes.
If the minutes are posted online after they're approved, that's fine. But it'd be great if we could be using the town website more for that kind of. I don't know how hard that is.
Yeah.
Anyway.
No, it's easy.
But I came for her. I'm
going to
stand up.
Just one second. So everyone's okay with making sure that the minutes appear on the town website after they've been approved?
Yeah.
The minutes and the agenda? Or is the agenda already on there?
The minutes are already on there.
So the agenda too?
I think that's what she's asking.
I just want to clarify.
The agenda and the minutes after they're approved. Okay. And the first minute.
Okay, so that'll become a routine item on the website.
Who will post those?
All right. I do the minutes regularly. So I'll just have the agenda.
She sends them to Bonnie.
Okay, Deb, you're on.
So I'm standing up and trying to project my voice because I came today because town meeting is all in our minds. We have been the beneficiaries of Bowen Mondavi's generosity every year, but after yesterday's vote to continue to hold meetings in our old halls, I thought I'd like to plant the idea that the town purchase a PA system. And I asked Bowen about that. And he said that for about $500, you could get a really good system with handheld wireless mics that would allow, we could get some kids to come and bring them to people so that the mics aren't only in one place. Mm-hmm. And he sent me some information, one idea. He also said you might look into getting some used mics. And then after he sent me this, he said, then you also have to buy all the cables. This is like beyond my technological know-how, but I am willing to learn about it and come up with a proposal if it's something that you would consider. If you're not going to consider it, I won't bother. But I would like you to consider it. I think that in Williamsville Hall in particular, the sound is more diffuse, and it's everybody's chance to be heard. So that's my plea.
Okay, thank you. Any immediate reactions from the board? Do you want to think about it, or what?
I think it's probably a good idea. They say while everybody walking to the front.
Get on smiling.
Yeah. What part of the budget would we use for that is one of my questions.
Well, that'll be a question all the time.
Come out of town meeting expense.
Mm-hmm. Town meeting expense?
And if it comes out of town meeting expense that we budgeted for next year, we won't have any money to pay for the actual items. We budgeted only $600 for town meeting next year, and we're going to have other expenses. So our $600 wouldn't cover. Just a point.
Let's listen to Greg, and I have a thought on it.
If I could just remind the board, I thought it was made very clear who the groups, people are that are interested in continuing those halls, and I heard more than three or four people say they're willing to pay. Mm-hmm. So maybe you might want to just consider putting the jar out and maybe you could use it towards that. If not, towards the rent overhaul or the getting the water running, all that stuff. But I mean, that was, I thought that was very clear for folks who are willing to step up money-wise. So
that's a good reminder. Perhaps what we can do.
And as a citizen, I'd like to see that take place, be honest with you, as a taxpayer.
Mm-hmm. Maybe what we can do is take Deb up on her offer to do the legwork and offer us a proposal when we know specifically what it's going to be. We can get the word out to the community and say, hey, we're following up on what you said at town meeting. This speaker system will cost $100. You can give your contributions to the town clerk or whoever you decide to be the person to accept it. Does that make sense to people?
Yeah.
If we do it that way, it's possible we'll have it for the next town meeting. If we actually want to budget it, then we probably don't get it until the subsequent town meeting.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Thank you, that was a good reminder. Are you okay with that, Ben? You really want to
I'm
do this?
I'm very pleased that you're in favor of it, and we'll see how we can make it happen.
Okay, so we'll look forward to getting some sort of
report. I'll do what I can. I think I'll start by seeing if anybody actually has equipment to old equipment to donate and start with that.
Okay. And I might suggest we do have some new paint, a new members here. We're willing to do legwork, so you might just tap into them for some help too.
Great, thank you.
Okay, was that it then?
That's it.
Okay,
except
thank you very
Ken,
much. Ken, you're on.
I'm on. Okay. As you know, from the great response of candidates for the school board, I am your school board. We have two open positions now that we voted the board down from five back to three people. The problem is we do not have a majority of sitting board members. So according to the Secretary of State's office and the Vermont School Boards Association's lawyers, I had sent you guys a letter, excuse the typos, probably bad for the school board member, but been fighting a lot of internal infection here. We fall under the category B under vacancies, where it's if there are vacancies in a majority of members of the town school board at the same time, the vacancy shall be filled by a special school district meeting called for that purpose. The remaining board member or members are authorized to draw orders of payment in continuing obligations and necessary expenses until the majority of vacancies are filled. Basically, what that comes down to is any Newfane school district items really can't get accomplished at the Newfane level, which there isn't that many anymore because of the joint contract board. The joint contract board under these circumstances can still continue because Brookline has three members. I would be the fourth member of six, which we would have a quorum. So therefore, at that level, things can get done. But meanwhile, to run, there's certain other things that need to be done at the Newfane level. They're really minimal, but they still, by obligation to the state, have to be done. So we need to warn a special school district meeting, and along with that comes we have to find, number one, find people to fill out petitions to run, get them, you know, their signatures, get them turned in, and in time to be put on a ballot and be properly warned in 40 days. And that's going to take up some glorious time. My suggestion is that we hold the vote in this building so she doesn't have to be out of the building again for the whole day and get behind on, you know, her regular duties.
So Ken, this is Australian ballot.
It has to be Australian ballot because that's how we do our
exactly.
elections.
Another question I would have is, in the fact that it was Australian ballot for the Leland and Gray budget, my question is, legally, and you can check with Stephen Johns, do we have to legally hold it at Union Hall? I misspoke when I said that we could do the Leland and Gray revote here, and it has to because it had been warned at Union Hall. Do we need to hold that at Union Hall?
I'm not 100% sure, but being that we hold our elections at different places for the, you know, for the school board vacancies,
right,
that, you know, we're at Union Hall or we're over in Waynesville, or that we could probably choose our own place. I don't, because where do we choose in between town halls? Because now, are we into next year? Do we hold it over there? Or are we still into this year because the vacancies from this year? Do we hold it over here? I would suggest that would be up to your discrepancy.
Okay, let me ask a question, Ken. Do you have any particular date or time period in mind at the moment?
I do not have any time period in mind. Next week is our first meeting.
What's your best guess about how long it would take to generate some interested candidates? Or is that even something that will happen? I'm thinking, Greg.
Go ahead. Somebody want to say something? Go ahead.
I just, I'm a little confused, Ken. You can't do any appointments now? I don't mean you personally.
I can't do any appointments.
I know you can. I'm saying, but there can't be appointments made? I've heard of folks that will take the job. I can't believe we have to have another election.
He checked with the Secretary of State's office.
The Secretary of State's office said that because if we had two board members and wanted to appoint another one, we could do that. Mm. But being that we don't have a majority of members to appoint, it's the law.
So I know that the select board has the authority to make some appointments for other town officials where there was no one elected this past week, but that's not the case with school board members. That's got to be done differently.
If I was not elected, it would have to go to the state's attorney's office. But being we do have one board member, it has to go to an Australian ballot by the town's special warned meeting for the school district.
Okay.
And my guess would be, I don't know how, we did have some write-in candidates. Unfortunately, they didn't get enough votes to go into office. My advice would be to get those names, contact those people, ask them if they're still interested. And if they're interested, to have them come down, see Gloria, get a petition and the proper paperwork, get the signatures in, and set a date. Or once you get a couple of people in, you know how many days prior to the election the ballots would have to be made up and et cetera, et cetera.
So as the lone school board member at the moment, are you in a position where you're able to give those folks a call and see if they'd be interested in
getting involved? If you give me a list, I will be more than happy to.
I will generate the list. We don't have it typed up for the town record book, but we do have a list of all the write-in candidates. We had four open positions, so I think we would take the write-in candidates for all of them because somebody was put in the second one and somebody was put in the first one. So my understanding is it would be logical to say that they all were write-in candidates for what now is the two positions.
This warning would have to include, being we had deleted the 2 1-year school board positions and I was elected to the 3-year term, that they are both 3-year terms, yep. One ending next year, one ending the following year. This way we won't have this problem of two people leaving the board at the same time where we don't have a majority.
Okay, just so that the board can speak with one voice on this thing, everyone's okay if Ken goes through the list of candidates who got write-in votes. Gloria will provide that list to him as soon as possible. He'll try to contact those people, encourage them to come in to get petitions to file for election. We'll need to, do we need to know in advance when the election will be, Gloria, so that petitions come in a certain time before the election? That's my understanding.
Set the meeting first.
So we have to set the meeting first for the election.
And all of that needs to come really from, I always get the warnings from the superintendent's office.
Okay.
So, is
so shall I work
the superintendent with, seems to want to stay out of this.
Yeah.
So, what makes sense to you, Ken, if we set the meeting, election a month from now, is that enough time?
I don't think we can do that because we have to warn it 40 days prior.
40 days, okay.
And you got to give time to get the petition come down, get the energy to come down here, get the paperwork, go around, have it filled. I mean, I know it's only like 17 signatures or something like that, but it's better to get 20 or 25.
13.
13. Well, it's always better to get 20 or better just in case, you know, somebody.
Okay, so does it make sense to set the date for the election 60 days from now?
That would make sense to me.
Is that doable?
If it's possible. Is it, if it's
yeah, and that's really, you know, it's not up to us as a select board to do that. So it really is up to, I mean, am I correct in saying that? It's really up to the...
I think what we're doing is just trying to cooperate with Ken on this thing. So if you're okay with one in 60 days and the board members are okay with one in 60 days, I think that's good enough.
Well, my understanding is it has to come to the town because you're in charge of the Australian ballots for...
I'm happy to do it in 60 days. I was just trying to figure January 27th, we needed to have the petitions for elections for the town meeting of March 4th. So somebody who does math better than I, is that like a...
You got at least 60 days there.
So we're going to have to back this up to allow them 2 weeks? You know, what's the time frame that we should allow them to get their petition signed? And then... if we say petitions need to be in by March X, then we have to have the 40 days.
And where do we go if we have nobody on the ballot, is my concern. Should we give it a little longer time? I mean, I'll talk to Chris Pratt, the principal at New Brook, and have it posted on the website, you know, that kind of stuff. And I do have people by word of mouth trying to get it out. Anybody else here, please feel free to.
So you're sure you feel board, more comfortable? Oh, sorry. Go ahead.
Are you sure the board can elect one or appoint one?
I'm 100%, like according to the, yep.
This thing. And
both of them, their term run out, the ones that left, right?
Or they were just simply not filled anyway.
The two that was left.
From
the two positions that are vacant right now have been vacant for 2 years.
But because we had a...
because Kim Friedman and Lisa Harris both had 1 year terms. And those are the two terms when they expired were the ones that we took off for at town meeting.
To try to address Mike's question, it looks like from the statutory language that it's clear that if there are no school board members, we clearly wouldn't have any authority to make any appointments because it says the Secretary of State's going to do that. We'll call the
if there's none.
Yeah, if there are none.
But we do
it doesn't seem quite as clear in the language if there is one, but Ken obviously has spoken with people who are saying that they're saying two things. One, they don't want to get involved if we can handle it some other way, and that it's okay if the town, in cooperation with the one member school board, sets an election to fill the position, is that correct?
Yeah. It's just, if I can get a date for the special election, I can write up the warning. It's only a one article warning. So,
okay.
You know.
Ken, could we just work together tomorrow?
You can
Friday?
Be here tomorrow?
I will come in for this. This is very important.
Okay. Just before we leave this in, are you okay with the 60-day horizon, or would you prefer to do 75 days or 90 days, which, I mean, you know what the workload is in the interim.
If somebody could just be appointed off the you know, off the floor, that would have been fantastic. Yeah. But unfortunately, our hands are tied there.
So 60 days is better than 75 days.
Yes and no, because we still have we have to get people to put on the ballot. We have to have the ballot, you know, and then you have to warn it for 40 days. You got to have somebody on the ballot to have the election. I don't think you can just have a write-in election.
Okay, so let me try this on the board then. You guys tell me if you're okay with it. What's being suggested is that we make the arrangements to hold an election 60 days from now. In the interim, Ken's going to beat the bushes for candidates who would provide petitions with the appropriate number of signatures to Gloria. The election would be held here in the town office, you're suggesting, Ken, so that Gloria doesn't have to go someplace
else. By Australian ballot, yep.
By Australian ballot. Anything else that the board needs to be keeping in mind as it makes a decision?
Nope. If you have elections here in the town office, can the rest of the people work here? I thought before that was the reason we went to Newark. If you have an election at the town office, that nobody would be working in the same room.
Actually, Emily Long suggested that we do change it back to the town office for Leland and Gray, so I'm just going on that.
Might want to just check to make sure we do it.
And we could arrange it so that they really are just channeled through the front door, unless they're physically handicapped. And we've had, certainly, when we had 43 people come to the Leland and Gray vote, we've had 43 people line up for dogs in a day. Mm-hmm. So the only one who would really be disturbed, I think, would be the listers.
Is it that, though, or is it legally they can't have anybody working here
during the election? Sandra Dowley said they always had them here.
Yeah, but what I'm saying is when they had them here, nobody else was working here.
That I will check on. Yep, absolutely.
Just to make sure we're legal on, that's all.
Okay. My understanding is as long as you cannot hinder the voters. So I believe, because back when Sandra used to have it here, there were folks here, but that aisle, I think, as Gloria said, if you have them coming in one door and out the other, anybody is, you know, there shouldn't be a...
Well, we certainly have people voting absentee here in the town office. That doesn't seem to have been an issue. Mm-hmm. Okay, so is the board okay with this approach, what we'll be aiming for? Oh, I'm sorry, go ahead, Dan.
I just thought I'd offer some dates for you. The 25th of March, I'm using Tuesdays because that seems to be always what things are. But if you got ballots in by the 25th, that gives you almost 3 weeks.
Petitions, you mean?
Petitions, right.
Okay.
Then you could legally warn it for, like, May 13th. I think that's 40 days. I didn't actually count, but that would, school would still be in session, and you could probably go a little later in March. You probably could go to March 28th, the end of that week, and still get your 40 days for Tuesday, May 13th election.
So Tuesday, May 13th is the suggestion?
I think it would
I'm just
trying to figure out, you know, it would meet the parameters of the time you need for legal warning, but it would also fulfill the urgency so that Ken isn't solo for too long.
And just a point of information, we're not wedded to Tuesdays because the Leland and Gray vote was on Wednesday. Mm-hmm. You know, if we wanted to make sure there was as few people maybe working, you know, we could do it on a Friday, because the listers don't work on Fridays. That's just a possibility.
Okay, well, it sounds like this is where we are. Gloria is town clerk who would be presiding over this election. If one of those days makes more sense to you than another, just let us know which one it is. As long as it's May 13th or a little bit later, we'll meet the parameters. You'll provide the information to Ken so he can beat the bushes candidates. And if that's okay with the board, we can move on.
I will point out that the biggest downfall of only having one school board member is Newfane has 3 votes on the WCSU board. And with only one person there, we only have one vote. And at that level, there needs to be more Newfane representation.
Just a question, Ken. How often would that board meet prior to, in terms of how many times?
Well, that's the other thing. The executive committee usually handles most of the business. They worked it that way because they had problems with quorums, that the executive committee took over a lot of the tasks. There'll be a reorganizational meeting the end of this month, which is pretty, you know, pretty standard. I don't see anything really credible that we really need that much support for up at that level, except for at budget time.
So we would have that member by then?
I would hope so. Yeah.
Okay, is there anything else we should be discussing about this right now? If not, let's get back to the other items on the agenda.
Thank you, Ken.
Thank you.
I'll see you tomorrow.
Thanks, Ken.
Okay, what, any particular time?
Why don't we set 9? Is that?
Okay, 9 is good.
Yep. Okay, appointments, road commissioner. I had an opportunity to speak with Chris Williams earlier today. He said if the board is inclined to appoint him, he would accept that and would like to continue. If that's the case, I told him that we would try to set something up where the voice of the road commissioner could be heard independently from the voice of the road foreman, so we're getting two perspectives on whatever is going on. So I mentioned his name. If someone would like to nominate him,
I'll nominate Chris.
We've got a nomination. Is there anybody else you'd like to consider for that?
Gary Katz.
You used to be
the road.
That's mm-hmm. true, yeah. But I'll pass in favor of Chris. Yeah. Anybody have any other nominations? Anyone from the floor want to pipe up? Okay, are we okay with Chris Williams as the road commissioner?
Yes.
Okay, all right. Confederate road commissioner. Emergency management committee. It's 5 people. Has anybody had a chance to speak with any of them?
I guess my question would be, Gary, is in what capacity would we have spoken to somebody when we weren't a convened select board?
Very often people on these who are serving these positions reach out to someone either in the town office or
okay, so they would have contacted
yeah,
us.
Yeah, I'm interested
okay.
in doing this.
Yep.
I take it no one's had any such outreach.
No. I would just do it the way it is, send them notices, and if they don't want to do it, then they can say they don't want to do it.
Okay, Todd, can you read out the names of the people who are on there?
So the last page of our...
Myself, Steve Jones, myself, Dave Miller, Jay Wilson, and Greg Record.
Okay. Todd, are you aware of anybody who really... Is adamantly opposed to continuing on this?
Greg, not listening.
You don't know anyone, Greg, who doesn't want to do this, who's sitting on the committee?
I'm sure it's going to be all
okay.
Okay.
So we'll send a letter to them.
Yeah.
It's okay with them, they're the people. Okay. Delegates to Windham Regional Commission, 2 people. Any outreach there?
Since Pete's here.
Pete's here.
Are you willing to continue?
Yes.
And I think Jody.
I think so.
Would be.
Okay.
Yeah.
Is the board okay with Pete and Jody?
Yes.
All right. Thank you. Animal control officer.
George Spring.
I.
George
second
Stone,
that.
Is, well, we've got a couple of people who'd like to see George continue there. Is that okay with the board? You ask George if you'd like to do that?
Yeah.
Okay.
Just a heads up, last I talked to him, he doesn't.
But he doesn't.
But I would suggest you do as you do, but I'm just to give you a little warning if he mm-hmm. writes back
okay.
and says no. So.
Okay. So it could go either way, but we'll give him the opportunity to say yes
right.
or no. Pound keeper. Is that still
Wyndham County Humane yeah. Society, yes.
And we still contract with them?
Yes.
Yep.
Are we connected with that contract?
Yes.
Fence viewers, 3.
Mm-hmm. Larry Robinson, Greg Record, and Ted Schreier.
George, you still okay with that?
And I spoke with Larry today, yeah.
He's okay.
Okay.
All right, let's send the letters to those three and
that's good.
See what we get. Inspector of lumber, shingles, and wood, one or more people.
Red Chafee.
Yeah, Red Chafee.
Carlton.
Yes.
And Red is still okay with that?
As far well, he as said last time he wanted a raise, but.
Yeah.
Double his salary.
Okay.
Is that okay with the board? We'll double his salary. Okay.
Yes.
All right. Red Chafee. Where coal?
Same person.
That's also ready.
Yeah.
Will we do both jobs for the same doubled salary?
No, we must triple it.
You must triple. Okay. Red Chafee. Representative to Rescue Incorporated did actually have a call from Wayne Clark this afternoon. He said he'd be happy to continue doing it if the board was so inclined.
Yes.
Excellent.
Okay.
Yes.
All right. We've got a rescue representative. Town Energy Coordinator.
Don Preem volunteered when we, Ed Druk Sr. said he didn't want to do it, and Don Preem volunteered, so I see.
I think Don would probably continue it.
Yep.
So we'll.
We okay
then?
So. I'll send the letter to
Don.
Okay. Good deal. Town Service Officer, Barb Williams. I think she's been doing it for a long time. I think she'd still want to do it.
Yeah, we can ask.
Okay. Anybody else want to compete with Barb on that one? No? Okay. Same thing? I'm going to just keep pushing through here unless someone
Absolutely.
Says something else. Tree Warden.
Bill Duncan.
Absolutely, Bill
Duncan. I'm sure Bill would be happy to continue doing that. Let's send a letter to Bill. Council on Aging Representative. I saw
Virginia there.
You still willing?
Yes, but I do think you should change the name to Senior
yes,
Solutions.
I'm sorry.
Yes.
Okay.
It is on this page.
It is on
our name. New one, it
oh,
is.
Okay, very good.
Thank you.
Okay, Women Solid Waste Management District.
Johanna Berger.
Yes.
Yes.
And Johanna's still okay with
this? I'm sure she is.
Oh, okay. She's been wonderful on that.
Yes.
Yeah.
And the board's happy with Johanna. Okay.
Absolutely.
All right. Women Waste Management District Alternate.
We didn't have an alternate.
We didn't
last year.
Have one.
Hmm.
Okay. We should have Johanna look into it, maybe. Maybe she knows somebody would do it.
Okay, maybe when we contact Johanna, we can follow up on Todd's suggestion then, see if she has a suggestion for an alternate. Okay, Vermont Greenup, two people. It's been Laura Bacon and Nissa Petrak.
I'm sure they're willing to continue. We did have the information from Richard Merrick that they're almost having to fold.
Yeah.
Oh,
so
the green bags are too expensive.
Wow.
Okay.
Anyway.
Okay, so we'll assume that Nissa and Laura are okay on that, and that's okay with the board. All right. Village Enhancement Committee.
Good.
Bud Bergman, Ed Drew, Chris Petrak, Nissa Petrak, John Spicer, and Todd Spicer.
Wasn't there a discussion that was
folded?
I thought we knew that last year.
Yeah, they weren't quite ready to pull the plug all the way, but they really felt like maybe it's time.
I would pass on it.
Okay. Is the board okay with just not asking anyone to serve on a Village Enhancement Committee at the moment?
I might suggest that we contact at least Bud Bergman to say, or Ed Drew Sr. to just say, should it just have died its death?
Okay, everyone okay with that?
Yes.
Okay.
That way we formalize it.
I think
in
so.
In our records, too.
Yeah.
Who's been serving as chair of that thing?
I'm going to say Ed, but that's just a
maybe.
Guess.
Yeah. I think John Spicer was.
I think he might have been.
Really?
Okay.
So maybe John is the one we asked about that one. Okay. So the Village Enhancement Committee may go. Planning Commission. We have two openings on the Planning Commission. Has anybody been approached by anyone who'd be interested in serving on the Planning Commission? At the moment, it looks like it's Ed Drew, Merle Tessier, Tristan Johnson, Pat Weisberg, Daniel Torrey, who's resigned, and I guess George Frayne's term has expired now. Is that correct?
George Frayne and Daniel Torrey. Right, those are the only two.
Does George want to re-up on that, or?
You know, I can't ask him, but he told me no.
Yeah, but I think he and
Tristan
and George was not going to continue, and then once the town plan was complete, Tristan was going to resign.
Is his term up? Is Tristan's term up now?
No, until 2016.
No. Oh, okay. He was going to resign after the town plan made its way through.
So there's two right now, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so anybody have any suggestions?
Maybe have the remaining planning commission guys try to find somebody for it?
That's a good option as well. Yeah. Can we do that, ask the planning commission to come in with recommendations?
Okay.
Shannon, just a maybe a personal thought on that. Gil Eisenhuth seemed to be interested in serving the town in some way. Maybe you can suggest that they touch base with him as well.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Would that be all right?
Yeah.
All right.
Would it be okay for this to be posted on our website? That we posted on the frontporchforum.com and just say anybody interested to contact Shannon.
Yeah, with a list of all the vacancies, yeah.
Okay. That'll be part of the total vacancy list then that we're coming up with it,
yeah.
Okay.
And I'm willing to upload that.
Okay, good deal. We've got a volunteer on it. All right, Development Review Board. We need an alternate on the Development Review Board. Currently, Pete is chair, David Cotton's vice chair. Ed Nelson, Ted Colligan, and Rick Wilson are the members, the alternates. John Mariano, Al Weisbrook, and of course, John Fifo had been an alternate before he passed away. Anybody aware of someone who'd like to be an alternate? You guys hear of anybody? Okay, so I guess we'll add that one to the list. Okay, Conservation Commission. Conservation Commission has Bruce Hesselbach, 2015, Greg, 2015, Sylvia King, 16, Miss Petrak, 16, and Mark Pickering, whose term has ended or is ending?
He had resigned.
Okay.
And I believe you folks dropped us down to a 5-member board,
you're right,
which requires a 3-member quorum,
yeah,
which is why we couldn't meet. So everyone there now is fine.
Okay.
That's
and again, yeah, just if you could post that there is a vacancy.
That's only 4 though, right?
Yeah, I mean, we're one void, but at least we can still, right. Now we can read.
Okay.
If you think all 4 of you will
yes.
agree again.
Yes.
Okay, so send the letters to them and add that additional vacancy to the postings that Gloria's going to do.
Just a question, Shannon. Do you have a record of last year there were people who were interested in that? Do you know to whom you sent letters? It seemed to me that Chris Treibert, there were people who were very concerned about the conservation part of it. And I thought we sent out.
That sounds right, actually. It would have been Pat that did it, not Shannon.
Right, yeah. But we don't have any. But anyway.
Well, I know no one came to our meetings, and nobody approached us with interest.
Okay.
And the only other, just a point of board, those terms are 3 years, so you don't need to. When I received my paper, it was for 3, it's a 3-year term, so you don't need to send out.
Oh, okay.
Right. Yeah.
We're all good for a while. So.
Okay. So it's just the one vacancy that we need to post.
Mm-hmm.
And I would assume that posting it the same way we post all the other vacancies is sufficient. And if anyone's interested, they'll get in touch with us or the group or the commission. Okay. Let's keep going. State Police Advisory Representative, I've been doing that the past few years. There's not been a meeting in 2 years. I think we can probably scratch that. And if the state police express interest subsequently, you can find someone to do that.
Okay. Yeah.
All right, so that one's gone. Williamsville Hall Committee. Myra Fassler, Marsha Highland, John Julian, Jim McNoy, Steve Levine, Chair, Phyllis Mandel, Nancy Reese, and Gene Bailey. Anybody have any reason to believe any of those folks don't want to do it again?
Then no, I think they... It might be Phyllis Mandel hasn't been going, but I hadn't heard from her that she was not interested. So.
Okay, so we can send the letters to all those folks, and if any of them don't want to do it, they'll let us know. Okay? New Fane Hill Common Committee.
Wasn't Eddie trying to...
That was another one. He was thinking about shutting that one down, but wasn't... He thought maybe there might be new people interested.
That one's a
maybe
question.
Maybe that's the one that I... No, but I think it was the other one, too.
Yeah.
He talked about not doing it anymore.
Right.
We should probably check with him again.
Yeah.
We'll send all these letters out.
Mm-hmm. So check with the same way we would check with Ken Spicer for the other one.
And just a point of information, today, the last one on the list, Kelly Warner, she has officially dropped the Crago from her name.
Oh, okay. Thank you.
Okay. All right.
I'm just going to say, she was also the officially elected two-year of a three-year unexpired term for Leland and Gray Board. So she is now a Leland and Gray Board member.
Okay, thank you. Town Office Building Committee.
Three of them said they wanted to continue.
Dennis was involved.
Mike the Granger and Duncan Gardner.
And you guys are all?
Yes, everybody's
okay.
They're proceed further.
Is that okay for board?
Yes.
All right, thank you very much, Dan. All right, comes to your elected officials' positions open. Any of these that we do decide to fill with a candidate would be for 1 year, and then the post positions would be open for election next year for the remainder of whatever term is being filled. So everybody's understanding?
Do you know what page you're on in terms of? I've been looking between this and so you're on the agenda.
The first page
okay.
of the agenda. Does anybody have a list of the vacant positions at the moment?
We've got Lister has one vacancy, Granger, town agent. That would be it.
Okay. Has anybody heard from anybody who would be interested in any of those positions?
The Lister one, he didn't want it?
Correct. He refused it. So.
Wow.
Yeah, we did have somebody who was duly elected.
Tom Dolan had
but he,
got
he
50
just,
votes and turned it down.
Yeah.
All right, I have a suggestion to offer then. Frank Sapansky was another write-in candidate for Lister. He had a number of votes. He's the only other candidate who did have write-in votes on that, as far as I know. You're willing to do that if the board says okay, Frank?
Yes, I am, Gary.
Wonderful.
I've done it before. Back and started in the 90s, I guess. And I was here for the 2002 reappraisal. As most of you know, I was also a selectman. It's not that hard a job. I've been a building contractor all my life. And I know quality. I know what it is. We don't have to train someone. I would take the job probably till for a year, and then if I decide to stay, I'd have to get elected. So, Doris and I have worked together in the past. I really don't see a problem. She's doing quite a bit of the work herself now. So. I'll take the spot if the board would choose to appoint me.
So despite Frank having been a selectman in his checkered past, he does have a lot of experience in Lister. Is the board okay with that?
Yeah.
Yes.
The last time we had a Lister position that was vacated, we put out and we had interviews, and I thought that would be the same process that we had.
Well, if he was a writing candidate, though,
Yeah, we have someone here, some
just,
people in town already voted.
I'd just like to tell the board that I called up five people, two of them are sitting at that table. If I called up two more, I would have had 13 votes. So I had 11. So it's kind of my fault.
So why didn't you call two more first?
Yeah, I should have. You know, it's
I'm good with
whatever.
The point is.
Yeah.
So you've been done before.
Yes, I'm fine with the point.
Okay. All right, well, we've got a majority anyway. So do we need to vote formally on that then?
I think it would be appropriate.
Okay. All in favor of appointing Frank Sapolsky as...
Going to make a motion for...
Oh, okay. I need a motion to appoint Frank Sapolsky.
I'll make a motion to appoint Frank Sapolsky into the Lister position.
And that would be for a period of 1 year, and then it'll go up for election next year.
That's not what you said, was it, Frank? You said you would be here 3 years and then elected?
I can't. I just get elected for one year from now.
1 year term.
But we didn't have a 1 year term that was open.
No, our appointments.
That's all we can appoint for.
You can only appoint for 1 year.
Okay. All right.
Todd, you seconded it?
Yep.
Discussion on this? All in favor of appointing Frank Sapolsky, please say aye.
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 Opposed? Okay, motion carries unanimously. And thank you, Frank, for being willing to do that. I hope you don't regret it.
Thank you.
Shannon, what were the other two?
Town agent, grand juror.
Okay, town agent, grand juror. Anybody that
what
wants
do these
step
people
up?
Do? What are the job descriptions?
Take the job and you'll find out.
It's a surprise, Ed, but you'll love it.
Did you say you wanted it?
No. Town agent. I never remember that one right.
Great to do it, right?
Okay.
May I read the description?
This is in the who's who of government. The town agent used to, past tense, prosecute and defend suits. The select board now has the authority. Thus, the town agent's duty consists merely of assisting when litigation is in progress at the request of the select board. Parentheses, generally not a very active position.
It's got your name on it, then.
I already have ulcers thinking about it.
Didn't we ask Bud Piatek on that one last time?
I think.
And he just said sure,
but we didn't.
It's been a vacancy the whole time.
It was never.
Oh, it's never. Oh, okay.
What about town agent?
Oh.
Was that town agent?
That was town agent.
Okay. What about grand juror? What is that one?
So that was.
Which one did you serve before, right?
Not much, but whichever one it was, I had to resign from the BCA if I it was a conflict, and so I gave that back. So I don't want to leave the BCA.
Okay. Ready for the grand juror? Helps to prosecute criminal offenses that occur in the town by giving information to state and local law enforcement. Parentheses, generally not a very active position.
In the absence of an outpouring of interest from the floor, I would suggest that we do two things. One is maybe give Bud Piatek a call to see if he'd like to have his name associated with those, and other than that, put it on the list of vacancies that we posted.
Right.
Is that okay with the board?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay.
I had a call in tonight to Bruce Passover. He's an attorney also in town, so.
Oh,
just so you guys know that. So he should come forward. Maybe
has he expressed any interest in it?
Well, no, that's good to know. That's perfect.
Just ask him if there's any way he might be interested.
Okay, I know there's not a vacancy in this next position, but I wanted to read this so that everybody understands it the same way. And this is what that list where he's been reading from says about select board members. General supervision and control over the town enacts ordinances, regulations, and policies for the town, oversees town property and personnel, prepares, presents, and manages budget, oversees roads, including laying out, discontinuing, and reclassifying roads, sits as local board of health, liquor control commission, and sewer commission, should know the town well, be able to understand all sides of complex issues, and have a very thick skin. That's the official description. But my reason for reading it is that that's a long list of responsibilities for the select board. And I want my colleagues to think about that, because the select board sometimes gets asked to get involved in additional types of activities. These are our responsibilities, so these have to be the priorities. Anything else that the board wants to do is great if we can fit it in with existing priorities that we really have to do stuff on.
You better watch it. You might be the one sitting here. Like, you'd be like Ken.
Yeah.
Okay. The only select board member.
Okay, so I think we've gone through the list of appointments. Covered all the elected officials. Before we go on to pay orders and adjournment, I'd like to share some suggestions with the board for how we might operate this year. But even before doing that, I was recalling a couple of things that happened at these meetings in the past. One was we used to have to readopt the code of conduct.
Yeah, I'll have those ready for the next.
Okay, so that's something we still have to do. But for everybody's benefit, that's the thing that talks about conflicts of interest and that sort of thing on the board.
Didn't we pass in terms of policy last year that we needed to sign that? Or
I think that's the point. We all need to sign it every year.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
We did.
The other thing that I recalled was rules of procedure. Is that something that the board that says that's something you can have for us at the next meeting as well? Sure. Okay. All right. I have some observations that I've just made as a citizen over the past year or two, and it led me to think that there are some things that the board could do really easily that might enable us to operate more efficiently and more smoothly, and maybe even keep meetings down in length. So I wanted to go through those with you guys, and if you're okay with them, we can adopt them and that can become part of the way we do business. Is it okay to do this? Okay. One point is that any authority that the board has rests in the board. None of us as individuals have any authority whatsoever as individuals. Everyone's clear on that, right? So nobody is ever going to talk for the board unless they've been explicitly directed to by the rest of us, right? Okay. Along that line, I recommend that in general circumstances, only the chair speak for the board, so we can direct all questions to one point, unless in specific instances the board has directly given authority to someone else to be a spokesperson for a particular purpose. Mm-hmm. Okay?
Yeah.
All right, I'm going to keep going.
Are we adopting them as we going along, or are we going to go to the end and be able to have a list? I'm just curious. Just said.
I've heard people say okay to the first two, so I wouldn't go back at the end with the whole list. And if someone's got an objection, please say it as we go along.
Yeah, I'd like to have a copy of the list and be able to go back and review it.
Mm-hmm. Okay, you're more than welcome to do that. Can we make a quick copy for Gloria at the moment?
Does anybody else want a copy?
Just as an observation, I would say these are pretty much what the rules we...
I'm going to say, with all due respect...
Yeah, I think that a lot of them are.
I think you're being redundant, Gary, because I'd like to think that the boards have always done what you have mentioned already. If they haven't, then perhaps it does need to be, but...
I would like to think it's redundant, really is, too, but I'm afraid that there have been examples where it hasn't. I can keep going in the meantime. Third one, since all the meetings that we have were video recorded and audio recorded as well, as I understand it, I would recommend that we consider having simplified minutes. I think legally all we have to do in the minutes is show the attendees, the motions that were made, the votes, the decisions and actions that were decided upon. But we don't need to go into detailed discussions of Todd said X and Mike said Y and Gloria said Z, and all those extra items in the minutes are what wind up making us take a long time to review minutes and takes time and get additional time in getting them out so the public is aware of it. It seemed to me, I like Greg's term of redundancy, as long as we've got those video and audio records, which we can have on the town website all the time, anybody who wants to go in and see the details behind these more streamlined minutes can do that with no problem. So if that's something that the board would be okay with, I think we could save a lot of time at meetings.
That's good,
yeah. Again, are we going to decide at the end or as we go along?
I think we're deciding as we go along.
As we go along? Yeah. Or do you want to do it?
I thought that's what we agreed Anyway, I do have one concern with that, Gary, is that there are people who do not have computer and they're not able to get cable television. Mm-hmm. So just an awareness that we would be denying. I absolutely agree it needs to be simplified, but there's a difference between simplified and being, this was the motion and that was the pass. For people who are reading the minutes and only have access to reading the minutes that are posted, for example, here.
They could always come in here and Shannon could put it on a computer or something.
So we just need to be aware that we have people who are 102 and they're not going to come in to do that.
I don't think they've been bad lately. They're like three pages. They're not.
Yeah. Well, is the board okay with giving a chance? If there's an uproar from the community, we can always change the decision in the future.
Sounds good to
me. Me too. I mean, one of my things is I'd like to see those, you know, the agenda be there a little more timely so that the public is aware of what we have on our roster and the minutes following as quickly as we can. And if we don't have 5-6 pages or 3 or 4 pages, it'll be easier for us to have those out and say, here's the business and how we conducted it. So that it can be posted.
I don't think you can get them down to 2 pages, but just
okay.
Simply by the amount of things you have in it, you're never going to get it down.
Okay.
That's
all right. Next item.
Point of information, the library has free computers. And so any citizen who wanted to go do the research on their own is welcome to the library to do so.
Good point.
And it's high speed, so.
That's a really good point.
And I had somebody come in to get a Vermont state tax form today who said, I don't use computer. We have a number of our aging population who are not computer literate. Mm-hmm. And they might at 93 go into the library and ask for assistance, but truly, I think we need to be able to accommodate them.
Well, there should be ways for us to accommodate anybody who's interested in it. If the video archive is not easy enough for some people to access, it is much easier for people to access the audio archives, and anybody who's interested can give Shannon a call and can even make arrangements to deliver it to someone who doesn't have the ability to get into town. Greg?
If I could just make a comment again, back when I was on the board, so before all this electronic stuff, and maybe I'm being a little old-fashioned, but I have been and still am, secretary of a lot of committees, and it was made very clear to me that minutes are not to be transcripts. They should not be transcripts.
Right.
And to get back to my original point, in the old days, the person read the minutes and didn't understand it, to a point I made a town meeting, I got phone calls. Mm-hmm. I had people contact me or the selectmen. What was meant by this? Let's not lose sight of that. It kind of bothers me when you say people have to go to a computer or have to watch a TV. You guys are here. Talk to people.
And the minutes will all be posted where they're always posted. So Greg is actually making a very good point. If someone is confused about any particular issue, all they have to do is call.
Ask a selectman. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Maybe an extra couple of phone calls. You still okay with this? Okay.
Yeah, that's good.
You're
fine.
The chairman. You have to do all the talking, so I'm just going to refer to you.
If that's the case, I'm okay with it. All right, and related to that, I'd like to recommend that that each of us as board members receive the minutes and review them before the meeting, and that if we see some error in it or there's some correction that needs to be made in it, that you let me know what those corrections are. I'll bring them up before the whole board in a very summarized fashion. If the board at all wants to make a change, we'll instruct Shannon to do that. Mm-hmm. If not, nothing further needs to be done. But the purpose here is to avoid time-consuming discussions or monologues at our select board meetings. Monologues like the kind I'm engaging in at the moment.
Very nice.
He was just saying, too, the video records can't be the legal records of the meeting.
Right.
But
they can or can't?
Cannot be.
Okay.
Cannot be. But they could be viewed, you know. They can, like you said, the minutes, just streamline it and then just, yeah, they can.
The minutes are still the minutes. It's as Greg was saying, they're never intended to be
changed. Right, you get the point across. It's just not a whole story about it.
Okay, so are we okay with that? Any corrections to the minutes will be provided maybe before the meeting. I'll summarize them at the meeting really quickly. You guys will say yes or no, and we'll go on with regular business. Okay? All right. This is also probably redundant. It's the chair's responsibility to establish the agendas. So I would request that the members let me know if there's anything in particular that they want to have on the agenda. And I further request that you let me know about it rather than going to Shannon, because I think that the board is best served if Shannon is responding only to one voice rather than all five of us hitting her from five different directions at any particular time. Are you guys okay with that?
And does that give the chair of the board the authority to not put agenda items on that have been requested?
No, as far as I know.
It couldn't, because if one of us want to pipe up under other business, we will. You know, I mean, if there's something that really we feel strongly about, I think we could do that. If I'm understanding your point as I'm reading this, I think what it's doing is it's making sure we've got a good flow going and a little bit more cohesion, so we're not all out in the stratosphere.
And I think maybe picking up on your point of having the agenda earlier, can we establish that by, Monday of the week of the select board, that all, you know, that we know of and think of have gone to Gary, mm-hmm. so that we could get the agenda up by Tuesday? Or should we set it for the Friday before, or?
The only thing to keep in mind is that I get a lot of calls on Wednesday. Right. Can I please be on the agenda? So.
But can't we, even up to an hour before, have that added legally?
You can. But do you want me to email it every time somebody comes to me and says
it strikes me, Shane's making the same point too. I think members of the public should be able to get on the agenda anytime they want to. So if someone calls you on Thursday morning and says,
and they do,
I'd really like to talk to the select board, there's no reason for that.
Right, exactly.
Right? Okay. Along the lines of the point we were talking about before on what I would, what I might try to do with the agenda, if there's a meeting where we've got 50 suggestions for agenda items, then I might well prioritize them so that we take care of the most important ones based on what we've been doing. But I'll always let you know if there's anything that I'm recommending we push off to another meeting. Is that okay?
Great.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. All these things are tied in. The board's instructions to Shannon, I'd like to again recommend that those go through the chair the same way the agenda items do. So again, she's only dealing with one voice. We okay with that?
Mm-hmm.
Seeing heads nod?
Yep.
Yes.
Pardon?
I said in addition to the other five that are already in my head.
That's Penny and the kids you're talking about, or someone not
important? I don't
know. Okay. Okay, here's a sensitive one. Because I know that we all wind up recusing ourselves from time to time on different issues. The most recent examples that have come up have been issues related to pay increases or issues related to contracting with Tansoon, because we've got a member of the board who's a contractor and two of the members of the board have their salaries paid by the town. I just wanted to clarify that recusal, if I'm correct on this, and maybe Pete, you can help me on this, I'm pretty sure recusal means no participation in the discussion as well as not voting in it. Is that correct?
That's my understanding.
Okay, I'm getting nods from Greg on that as well.
And the ultimate, I believe, is to take yourself out of the room so you can't go.
Yeah. Okay. So is that okay with folks? If there's anything where one of us has to recuse him or herself, what we'll do is physically remove ourselves from the room so that we're not influenced or rest in any other way. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Good. Okay. Next item. I'm almost done, so we're just going to get out of here at a reasonable hour. I understand that the relationship between the board and the treasurer has been a two-way street that's had bumps in both directions. What I'd like to suggest, because I think it's really, really important that the board be as fully aware as possible of what our financial situation is like, I'd like to suggest that we formally and respectfully request the treasurer to join us on some regular basis. And I think I would ask your views whether that should be every week or once a month, certainly not less than once a month, I think. And assure her that she'll be treated by the board respectfully, and that that we'll value her her input and really need it to be able to serve the town's interests. Is that okay if we do something like that?
Okay.
What about the timing? Do you think, is this something where it's valuable to ask Maureen to be here every week, or?
We don't meet every week.
I'm sorry.
Yeah.
Twice a month, probably once a month.
Once a month, okay.
And then the only other thing that I can think of that came up recently would be, if she's over there and it looks like we're running low on cash, so we don't have to scramble for a loan, maybe that might be an immediate situation where we get a heads up. But other than that, I think if we're doing it on a once a month basis, it's really important to keep that tie-in so that the board isn't just off, making recommendations we shouldn't.
Yeah, okay. I would, respectfully say that we can. She wasn't elected to be on a select board, so asking her to attend half of our meetings, sort of just in case. So I would suggest that we ask her again with X number of days prior to that we have the very specific questions, because she's going to have to research that. State laws are changing all of the time. She can't just whip up with an answer. So what are our specific questions? I think that would be part of the respect for her position.
I think there are two different points that we're dealing with over here, both of which I think are legitimate. The point that Gloria's making there follows up on Chris's point, that there may be occasions when there's something very specifically that we need to pursue to make sure we understand so that we don't make a bad decision for the town. That's the one set, and there I think giving Maureen as much notice as we can on the specific issue makes sense. But the other aspect of it can, and I would suggest, should be done on a routine basis. Maureen is not a member of the select board, and I don't want to suggest that there's any obligation related to select board that way, but she's an elected official of the town, and the town is better served if all its elected officials are working as closely together as possible. So if you guys tell me that we can go without some sort of regular financial status report from the treasurer, then I'd withdraw this suggestion. If we need that regular financial status information, then I think we have to talk with Maureen and establish an arrangement that provides it and be as pleasant and diplomatic as we can, but not not handicap the select board so that it doesn't have information it needs to be able to make decent decisions for the town. What do you think?
Again, with all due respect, we did receive today. She has been providing these on a regular basis. These are all the expenses, all of the revenues, and we didn't get it until today. I'm not implying, but we have this to look at. So this is where we would flag, and she can, as Shannon did during a meeting, do, these are all the budgets that are over.
I actually showed her where I found that, so she included that.
So we have that included. So I'm not quite sure what we would expect her to just come and be here.
Well, no, I think we have a responsibility to go through the report, And if we understand it thoroughly, then we don't have any questions for Maria. Mm-hmm. But if there's something we don't understand, it's very valuable to be able to ask the treasurer, what does line X mean? What are the implications of that? I mean, it looks like we're over on line X budget-wise. Are we going to recover before the end of the fiscal year on it, or is this something we really need to be concerned about? There are going to be questions that the board will have, and nobody can answer those questions except the treasurer. And for us to do it in a way where we go back to her after the fact, we look at the report, and then it's 2 weeks before we have the information, that's a situation that doesn't seem like the best way to be doing the town's business if we could get the question answered the day of the meeting. I don't know. You guys have been dealing with it much more recently than I have, so if it's not a problem, tell me and I'll forget it.
I understand probably what you're saying, and I, as a person, could go over and ask Maureen, hey, we've got this going on. I think that my sense of it is, and it may not be once a month, but I think the idea is that as a five-member board here, as our job is to work for this whole town, mm-hmm. is to have that communication line. And if I go and talk with Maureen because we're working on flood stuff, it's not quite the same as her taking 5 or 10 minutes at the beginning of a board meeting so that we all could say, hey, where do you think we're going here? Do we have a problem if we're $3,000 over in this line item, and how does that affect this other balance, even though we can see it? You know, so for me, it may just be that 5 or 10 minute tap on, hey, give us a guidance on your views, because you're the one sitting here behind these books, and you've got some feel of what you think's going on financially, and I think that's extremely valuable information for the five-member board, so that if we're sitting here making $1,000 decision on a safe or not, you know, maybe we need to pause, but we don't really know that we need to.
I would point out one other thing. I mentioned it when I went through the select board members' responsibilities, but one of the major ones is manages the budget, and you can't do that if you don't understand what's going on. You don't know what's going on. Right?
Yeah, when they get the phone calls, they're calling you, not the treasurer.
Is it all right?
Sure.
Okay.
Please.
So I'm listening to this, and I'm wondering if, in light of all the streamlining that you've also proposed to keep these shorter, and forgive me, I don't know how you work, but it seems to me that maybe it would make more sense to get a treasurer's report beforehand. And I'm concerned about the treasurer also having enough time to do all the work if she's also coming here at night. So I'm wondering if you're taking on all this heat, Gary. Yeah, I mean, you just made yourself the spokesperson, and you're going to be the liaison to Shannon. But shouldn't you be meeting with the treasurer, or somebody else being assigned to meet with the treasurer and to report back? When I ran Tim's business and I had to do reports, it's like it takes a while to figure out what the report is, so that you'd be waiting here. And, you know, it's like it would ruin all this great streamlining you've just achieved, is what I'm thinking. And
I'd like to discuss it, but let's see what Greg has to say. Are you finished?
Well, I think that you absolutely need this information. I just don't know that having someone come here physically in case you have a question it seems like reports and studying beforehand would be more efficient to every use of everybody's time, and that's part of budgeting, is efficiency.
Yeah, that sounds like a legitimate point. Greg, and then Dennis.
Well, I guess to go with Deb saying it, a lot of the other organizations I've been involved with, and still have a lot of them, that is a standard agenda item, treasurer's report. Mm-hmm. So I think you guys, if you haven't been getting that, that definitely needs to be had. Now, as far as her having to come here physically, I think the good part that Chris made was that, again, I'm just throwing this out, I'm not by any means telling you what to do, but if you're ahead of me when she comes and you say to her, okay, give us a report, what's bad? I mean, that's when the committees and stuff that I'm on, that's what happened. Treasurer's report, what's up? And that's what they tell you. okay, look, we're this is God, this is that. We've got to be careful here. This is going on there. Now, I realize she lives a long ways away, and if it's going to be just a two-minute report, you know, that's probably going to be a hassle.
Right.
But I want to emphasize, I think, is that, that yes, you've got to have that information one way or the other. But I said, you may want to suggest to her, we'll pick a certain time, and then you come in, you talk to us. Don't wait for us to ask you questions. Tell us. You know, that's her job. Mm-hmm. If she's working that part of it. Tell us what we need to know.
Can I just find out why that's her job when we are the ones who oversee the budget? She oversees the payments. She oversees the handling of the finances. We have hired Elaine Perkins as a select board to do the reconciliations. I'm a member of other boards. We definitely have treasurer's reports, but that's, you know, what would you want her to report in that? The treasurer of the Southeastern Vermont Watershed Alliance reports, I deposited this much money, and I wrote this many checks, and this is what our balance is. Is that anything different from what your treasurers of your committees do?
Well, no, but there's a little bit, again, you get back to what Gary's saying, I think the one-on-one, you guys are supposed to be working together. If she doesn't want to do this, that's fine. I would say the same thing. Make the offer.
I think that's where you have to, before we leave Deb's point, because I think it was a good one, the difference in this instance is that I think all five of us are going to have to understand the financial aspects of it, and that's not quite as easy for one to take and to translate to the others because things get lost in translation. That's the only reason why I think it's valuable for us to have Maureen here in person. If we were all CPA sitting up here and fully understood everything and every implication in those reports, maybe, and I'm still saying only maybe, I wouldn't see it as being quite as necessary. But that's not the case. And look, say that we're dealing with an issue over here, and it'd be valuable for us to know when our currently outstanding loans are due. That's not something.
Well, yeah, that's thing of it is, she's going to deal with the school. She's going to deal with the town. She's got other bills, and that's where we run into trouble. A lot of times, we don't realize that she's got to pay the school first. We don't have any other money there, so she has to borrow money. That's why she shouldn't. I think she should be here once a month just to make sure that we know that, like, she's going to pay $500,000 of the school. We've only got $505,000 there, but we got another $50,000-$60,000 in bills that we're going to have to go borrow for.
Mm-hmm. I think that's exactly the point. The board is handcuffed in a way if we don't have that information. I mean, we can stumble through, and what it may simply mean is that we pay a little more interest on a few more loans. But if we can avoid that just by cooperating with each other, why not?
Right, it's not her fault. She's got to pay the bills, but yeah, we need to know if we got to borrow money.
Well, Dennis.
Gary, that particular report that you're looking at, I believe it's probably the same one. I don't think it's changed in recent years. That's a very detailed report that really tells you line by line exactly where everything is, where you are year to date. And if you look at it, or at least I always found, Maureen would give me that a couple of days ahead of time. And I would look at it, I would highlight the areas that I saw were out of line, like maybe we budgeted $6,000, we're only 3 months into the fiscal year and we've already spent $5,000. Those were the things that, you know, you could give to her ahead of time where she can have an opportunity to research those. Because I don't think you can put the treasurer on the spot and ask her, have her come to a meeting and just pop questions at her.
Right.
She's not gonna have the answers. You gotta have time to to research those answers.
So maybe what we're talking about is if on a monthly basis we get the report sufficiently in advance so that we can all review it and get questions back to Maureen, ask her to join us at that next meeting to answer the questions. Is that
report will also answer a lot of the questions.
But in that report, she needs to tell us that this month they're coming right up, I've got to pay Leland Gray $500,000. Mm-hmm. Or the school's $500,000, should be included in there that you only got $200,000, so I'm going to be coming to you guys here pretty quick looking for money. We need to know that. That's where we ran into trouble last year. Yeah. And it's not her fault.
No.
She had so many other things to do, and we weren't keeping track of it the way we should. If we're going to do that report, then it should say another, should be another page of that that says, this is where we stand with these accounts, this is what I've got to pay, this is how much we've got.
A lot of times you'll see that shortly before, like, the beginning of April. Things are looking pretty bad, but the 15th of April, you're going to have tax money coming.
Right.
And those are the little things that you learn.
Well, are there other thoughts on the floor?
Yeah.
Pete.
The thought that I had would be that you take this question, some of the suggestions that have come out tonight, and talk to Maureen and see what her outlook at this particular point is. See if she has a suggestion as to how to, how to amass the information that she thinks will be useful for you, how to get it to you, get it to you in a timely fashion, and respond to any questions you may have.
Sounds like a reasonable approach.
And just Gary, my perception has been, so speaking of timing, if this had gone into the mailboxes, let's say Tuesday, would all of you have picked it up to review it by Thursday? That might be the same, you know, the same perspective of the minutes. You know, don't come into the meeting without having read the minutes and gotten you.
I think you're making a good point. We all have to accept our responsibility in this too. So if the arrangement works out being that the report will be in our mailboxes on Tuesdays, then I think we all have to agree to look at the reports and get our questions back so we can share them with Maureen in advance of the select board meeting.
And we can even scan them and attach them electronically, mm-hmm. put them on emails.
I will just add one thing. So it's like a point of clarification. These reports are great. They are very detailed. The only concern that I have is, as you know, they're a backward report. So as we're doing, as you know, we got caught pretty good here last fall. As we're doing this and we're going through and signing the pay orders and thinking about what we're setting up for movement, we don't yet know that ahead Maureen's got $700,000 that's got to go out. So that's really all we need is that, whether it could be a sticky note,
that
doesn't have to come to the board.
Should be the next one more page.
That's an easy do for her.
That's what we need.
That's a really easy do.
We need those little taps. So there's that communication. Here's what the view is forward, guys, as you're working.
Absolutely.
That's the critical part.
Absolutely.
So what if that follow-up to Pete's point on this, that the next logical step is to sit down with Maureen, express the interests we have in different types of information, see what her suggestions are for how it can best be shared, and move from there.
So you're going to do that, Gary?
I'll be happy to do that.
I mean, you're the spokesperson.
I'll be happy to do that. Chris, having some experience with some of the finances over the past couple of years, would you be willing to join me for that so you make sure I ask the right questions on it?
Sure.
Okay. Okay. And Shannon, will you help us set something up with Maureen where we sit down at a convenient time to talk with her about that? Okay. All right. Next thing. We appointed people to numerous committees and commissions. And one of the things that struck me as we were going through that is that on some of them we weren't sure whether they were active or not anymore. I was wondering if the board might be interested in getting some sort of regular report from each of the committees and commissions. I don't know how frequently it would have to be, but something that lets us know that they're alive and well and doing something and that it's something we want them to be doing.
Does
that sort of thing
make
sense?
They should be taking minutes anyway, right? If they're taking minutes, then they should be sending them to Shannon.
I always get Conservation Commission minutes.
Do you get any of the other?
Okay, so is it okay for us to the various commissions and committees to provide us with a regular report after each of their meetings?
We should be getting minutes.
Okay. So I guess the suggestion is that they should be keeping minutes and that they need to be shared with us following their meetings.
That's not true. I get the Williamsville Hall Committee minutes too.
Okay.
Just a question in terms of the paper. Are we going to expect a paper copy of those, or could we just have a scan and look at them electronically? Or have Shannon could upload them maybe on, or whatever, on the website? I'm just concerned about stacks of paper.
Do we all look at the things electronically? If we do, why not just have it in?
Mike, how do you feel about that?
It doesn't bother me either way.
Okay.
I get them, so.
Okay.
Okay, so somehow Shannon will convert that to an electronic format for us. Good deal.
We do that on our new.
Okay, the last thing I had on the list is that whenever we have committees and commissions operating in the town, they're doing that as creatures of the select board and don't have any authority to go off on their own to, you know, to buy a carousel for the town common or something like that. Is it clear in your minds that all the committees and commissions understand that their responsibilities are to make recommendations and proposals to the select board, and that the board's approval is required before any actions are taken? Is everyone comfortable that that's the way it works, or is that something we need to make sure everybody understands?
I'm not sure where you read that or what. I mean, what are you basing that on? Because I guess I've never seen when the Planning Commission did the town report, they did their business and they had to come to us. An example of what might have been action taken that.
And I simply would suggest that the mere fact that we weren't sure whether some of these committees still exist or not begs the question of what's going on. And if we're receiving regular reports, we would know that yes, the committee is active, this is what it's thinking about. We might very well want to suggest, within our responsibilities, that we like what you're doing over here, but we think you might want to take this into account as well. I mean, that's our responsibility. The members of the committees and commissions aren't the folks who have the elected official responsibility. We do. So it would be irresponsible of us, we'd be abrogating our responsibilities if we didn't stay on top of what was going on and offer some direction.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, ma'am.
I may be incorrect, but this new thing, the new committee, I don't think the board even knew about it.
New thing is not a town committee, not a committee that the board established, right? It's a private.
I thought you were talking about any type of committee. I think they got funding.
Mm-hmm.
No?
No.
Okay.
Mm-mm. No.
But it's a good point. There may well be private committees that form for whatever reason, and it seems to me they're free to do whatever they want. If they'd like some assistance from the town in any way, they've got to make a recommendation to the select board.
But the point I'm trying to make is, whatever type of committee it is, in the long run, it may impact the whole town. So shouldn't that come before the board?
What do you guys think?
It depends on the type of committee.
Exactly.
I mean, if you have the Planning Commission, certainly there's a rapport there.
I'm not talking about...
Certain committees, no, they don't have any... They're independent. And then they can be joined. Like Williamsville Hall, town owns that building, and you have a committee that operates that building, so that certainly they... work back and forth with the board as well. So it depends.
And just to bring up, because Mike was here, Todd and Christine were here, I did bring up, as somebody who's on the new thing anew, couldn't we put a line item in our budget and have all of the finances, which are actually individual donations having given receipts, come through? And you said, or John said, but then it would come under the select board, and we would have to come and to be able to spend that money. So the,
you're suggesting revenues coming into the town from
that. I brought that up at
Oh, before.
Before.
I see. Now I'm following.
No.
Okay.
So before I brought it up to the board, and it was your discussion that said, you know, don't do that.
Right.
So, I mean, and you weren't on the board at this point, but we could refer back to the PCTV.
Yeah, that's what you're
I
watching.
Wasn't, but from what you're saying, I think that the board made the right decision. There's no reason for a private committee to be circumscribed by the town's requirements or vice versa. So we're okay that the committees understand their responsibilities, and we don't have any loose wheels on the vehicle, right? Okay. That's what I had. Thank you very much. I really do think this will help us operate a little bit more smoothly. Before we go into our pay orders and adjournment, is there anything else that anyone from the public would like to share with the board?
I'd like to make an
announcement. Let me just see what the folks have first. No? Okay. Frank?
I'm going to go sit in on a school board meeting, the next one, to see if it's something that would interest me. I'm really bothered that the school board only has one person on. I believe a lister can be on the school board. I'm going to go sit down when my children are, I'm a grandpa, so my children are up and grown. I have no agenda, but they control an awful lot of money. And it's really sad that people are moving to our town. They need to get involved with our town. They want to live here. They need to get involved with some of these boards in this town, because this is the way we operate, just what we're doing here tonight. This is what we do. People want to live here, they want to move here, they need to get involved. I did 8 years, 6-8 years as a lister, I did a year as a selectman, now I'm going to be a lister again. People move here, get involved with your town. That's all I ask.
Thank you, Frank. Deb?
You know, I wasn't allowed to talk except to say, all those in favor say aye the other day. So when you invite me to speak, it's like, this is my chair. So I've been thinking about this committees thing, and it sounds to me as if there's a way, that there's a need to bring all the committees together. And the way you're wording it sounds a little draconian, like we want to control them, and we're already having such trouble finding volunteers to work for the town. And I don't know that people are going to work if they're feeling like, you know, Big Brother's going to approve them or disapprove them, or, you know, and I'm not saying that you can't have control, but you also, we also have these committees that don't know they're supposed to take minutes, don't know they're supposed to give their minutes to Shannon, you don't know whether, I'm wondering which village is the Village Enhancement Committee the committee of? Is it one, you know, there are three villages in town. So I'm wondering if there couldn't be more like a, and I'd be willing to help
party.
Help do this, but yeah, exactly, a party for all the people who serve on committees that had some meeting component to it, saying, you know, these are the expectations, these are the responsibilities. We also invite people, we'd like to know what you're thinking. What are you doing? What are you doing on that Village Enhancement Committee? Anyway, that I understand your concern and your responsibility. I'm just wondering if there's a way to make it an invitation so that we do get more people, including newcomers to town, people who've only lived here for 15 or 20 years, to step up and be involved.
I think you're making an interesting point. I'm sorry if it sounded draconian. That certainly wasn't my intention. What I do feel is very important, though, is that that the responsibility for what happens with town resources resides with the select board. And that's why I keep asking these guys if they're okay on any of these. So I assume when you said you were talking about all of us on the select board.
All of us.
Yeah.
All of us.
So I think, I really believe that the committees are all filled by well-intentioned people who want to do what's best for the town. And I'm simply suggesting that's not enough, that these folks are the people who have the responsibility to make sure that it's in the best interests of the community as a whole, whatever it might be. Now, I can't give you an example and say the Village Enhancement Committee wanted to put up a toll gate in South Newfane. that doesn't seem consistent with the Village Enhancement Committee. You know, I can't tell you that. But if assuming everybody's working on the same page, then what's wrong with the committees sharing with the select board what they propose to do?
Nothing at all. I do remember, however, that when I was on the Williamsville Committee, it became very much an antagonistic relationship, which was really unnecessary, and why I left the committee, because I don't think that committees that are all working for the town should be adversarial. And I just hope that we've got these committees, we don't know what they are, maybe there's a way to have the oversight that you are, that's deposited on your shoulders, and for which I am incredibly grateful that you guys are willing to do this. But I think there's a way to do it that can encourage more people to serve. And I'm willing to help.
Well, I think what Gary's talking about, one thing though, a good example is, there's a couple things in here we're not sure if they're still going to do, right? Like the thing with the cemetery thing or up on the common on the New Fane Hill. Mm-hmm. We don't know if they're continuing that, right? Where if you had, like you said, that report or the minute thing come from each one of the meetings, mm-hmm. we'd know them guys don't want to do that no more, and you'd cross that one off the list.
Absolutely, yeah. In agreement.
But we had already agreed that in this handout, it went from, yes, we definitely want the minutes, to we need to have approval. So that, I believe, is, it's a second issue, and I think we all agreed we want minutes. But we need to get the select board approval of any recommendations before any actions are taken. That's your final point? Does that differ from just getting minutes?
It does differ. It differs markedly. Say that we get the minutes, and the minutes do say that our Village Enhancement Committee plans to put up a toll gate. They don't have any authority to do anything like that, and that's outrageous, obviously, and I'm doing that purposely. But they have no more authority to do something that's less outrageous if it's going to involve town resources. That's our responsibility. So with that responsibility, and I'll speak for myself now, and this is a board, and I want that to be perfectly clear. As objectionable as any view that I personally might have to anybody, that's not going to be the town policy unless it's joined by at least two other members of the board. So it's going to be a board decision. If you guys don't think that we need to have approval of these things, that's okay. Say that you don't need it, and we won't get it, and I'll be quiet.
Yep. Gary, I'm not questioning that so much as, okay, we have minutes. They come in. What's the requirement for town meeting, for example, is within 5 business days. The draft has to be available. So they said on Thursday that on the next Monday they're going to put up that toll booth, and they go ahead and do it. Then we get the minutes, and it's already a done deal. So I'm just trying to figure out the logistics of, do they need to report that before they take any action that has any money involved? For example, did the Planning Commission need to come to us prior to spending the money to have the town plan printed at Staples and to have the zoning bylaws printed? That's financial. Mm-hmm. Yes, part of their budget. And so should they have had, that's the very concrete example. Like, should they have had our approval to do that prior to their actually doing it?
Well, I think that's a great example.
Okay.
And they had the approval, and we approved the budget. Right. That was the select board saying you can spend that money on these things. But what I'm suggesting is, if any of the committees or commissions comes up with something that we haven't been asked
about. Okay, so that's before, it's yeah, just basically a hypothetical. Yeah. Okay.
It is, again, I'm saying you guys saw it. That's, to me, is a defining line. If these committees, for example, the Conservation Commission, we have a budget.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's $50 or $100, whatever. We don't come to you
right
to ask permission to mark the trails.
Right.
That is part of our. So you may see in our minutes, we went out Friday night and we marked the trees and cut some brush and. But that's being done because we totally understand the fact we are not allowed to do anything
Yeah, okay.
That approval was given to us because you gave us money to take care of that. So I think the budget, as you said, the same with the Planning Commission, if they've been given money X amount, which they always have, and they've always had a line item in the budget, I mean, it's, you know, to that, that degree.
So just so that we're very clear on it before we move on, what is the board's pleasure in regard to prior approval for new proposals from any of the committees or commissions?
For financial expenditure.
That involve financial expenditure for the town.
Sounds logical.
Ernest, while I'm thinking, go ahead.
Add something on that. I think in some ways the amount of money that the particular committee is handling, really maybe there needs to be a place where you have to go to the board. Like as the town office building committee, we've got a pretty big budget for things that we need to do to this building this year. I think it's over $30,000. Maybe we're going to do windows. Maybe they're going to cost $10,000 or $12,000 to replace the windows. But I'm not sure what Greg is suggesting here, but I think something like that big certainly needs to get approval from the board. Just because we've got a $30,000 budget, we can't go out and throw windows in the building without letting the select board know about it.
I think that's an excellent point.
Is there a policy that says they can only spend so much?
Yeah.
Maybe they go to the board. Explain that.
Our bidding process is, it's $2,000, right?
So,
I think Dennis is making a good point. The distinction is between something that's going to cost a lot of money and something that's $50 for clearing brush from the trails. And I don't know what went into the budget process this past year, but if the $30,000 was based on $12,000 for windows, $18,000 for this, and the board already said yes, then I would say even though it's that amount, you already have the approval because they said yes. But if the $30,000 is more amorphous and we don't know what you're proposing, then I think that it does make sense to bring that back before the board. There's also another reason for bringing big expenses back. Say in the budget process we said $12,000 is fine for windows, but there's some disaster before we get around to dealing with the windows, and it would make more sense to spend that $12,000 some other way. I think the board has to make the decision that says, yeah, I know we budgeted it this way, but things have come up and we can't spend it that way this year. We'll budget again for next year, but we have to spend that $12,000 differently this year. And that's a responsibility of the board.
I'm not sure about that because that money was allocated by the voters.
Yeah, I know, but in any budget,
I'm not sure is what I'm saying.
The money is spent between line items is at the discretion of the board.
I think the town office, the money that he's talking about was in capital anyway, so there's no place it can be spent.
Okay, so, but say there's another capital need.
Right.
I'm speaking hypothetically. But
right.
The point is that we can't operate blindly. If there's something more important that the town needs to do with its resources, then the select board is the only responsible group for saying that we have to do this. I'm sorry if it means that your committee can't do something you'd like to do, but we've had a flood in the town office and we have to take care of it or something. I don't know what the specific case would be, but what I do know very clearly is that as creatures of the select board, the committees and the commissions have no authority other than what the select board is willing to let them have. And I'm using authority specifically because the responsibility never, ever leaves the shoulders of the select board.
Can I just point out another thing that does impact the budget? For example, when I first became town clerk, I had a given budget. I was informed when it was this massive cleanup that it was okay to spend my two line items as for my assistant town clerk instead of for recording. However, when it came to the audit, that had to be pulled off because you couldn't by line item combine the two line items, and it needs to be a minute somewhere, but it was very clearly presented to me by at least two of you who are still sitting on the select board, that as long as I didn't go outside of my two line items. So, for example, we had something, I had to buy extra storage things. you know, they don't fit the line item. And so the auditors pulled that and said, you know, it needs to go to small office equipment. So just being aware that it, and we do, according to the, you know, when I talked to Jim Barlow at the Vermont League of Cities and Towns, we absolutely have the right, but it gets floated and then it doesn't, you can't buy a truck, stupid example, you can't buy something and just take it out of a line item. We would have to appropriate that money as a select board, and then it would show as it matches up in the end.
I'd like to move on, if we can, just make one last point over here. I think you're absolutely correct that we have to account for whatever we did with the money, but I also am pretty certain that the select board is not bound by the existing line items.
I agree with that.
Any last comments before we move on?
You had a hand up.
I just wanted to mention Williamsville Hall because this actually came up. So I'll tie a couple of things together. The importance of the reports, or the rapport, is really the way I like to put it. Mm-hmm. And the electrical that is required and is going to be needed for Williamsville Hall. So as we went into budget this past year, we realized, you know, the real cost to bring this up to code in two parts is going to be more. And that's why that give and take over one, two, three budget years is really critical, so that we know, hey, we really do have this need, and how do we get that done as an important item? So we now have Williamsville Hall into the capital movement to make sure that we upgrade the electrical, if that makes sense. That's the importance. I think this conversation kind of went more into a control issue, and in some senses that is the board's responsibility as I see it in this way. You know, if we have X number of dollars and that has to go out toward all these things, it's really the board as a whole to say, okay, this is what we can do with that and here's our budget, and then we present it to you at town meeting and you say, good job or not so good, we'll give you, you know, but we still got to work within those confines. So that's my little.
Thank you.
Gary, I'm sorry to prolong this, but just a quick thought. You're absolutely right, it's the responsibility of the board to control all of these things. But it seems to me that the committees and commissions are different, and to blanket them with some sort of a reporting or request thing, I think might be a mistake. I think that the board probably would be better off identifying those that it wants to approach and explore the question with, and see how that works. And then the party would be to thank everybody for their service on commissions.
Good suggestion.
Yeah.
Pete, what's the distinction you're drawing between the commissions and the committees? Just
names, nomenclature.
Yeah. Okay. So where are we staying on the whole issue related to committees and commissions? Would we like to try to pursue this a little bit further to learn a little more about what the various committees and commissions are thinking about for future reference? Should we invite them to one of the select board meetings to talk with us about it, or what? We're getting some nods, but a no over here. What do you guys think?
Invite them one committee at a time to the next select board meeting if they want to come. At least one representative.
I just think to get the whole committee there.
So the committee, like Liz Hall committee, Steve Levine, and whoever's the chairman, comes just to say, this is kind of what we want to do this year, go over with us and say, yeah, okay, whatever. Right. And then whatever other committees are out there, the enhancement committee, if they're not going to function, then they probably should just write us a letter saying we're done.
So does that make sense to everybody? Yes. Should we extend invitations one committee and commission at a time?
Yeah.
Do you have any preferences for which ones get invited first?
Can we just get Shannon to give us a list first of what committees we have out there? And then the next meeting, figure out what we're going to do with those.
Are there any other than what's on this sheet that we have in front of us?
No. Just a question. If we do that once every 2 weeks, are we going to get to the end of the year and we will not have met with one of the committees? Just a question. Should we invite maybe three representatives to a meeting? So I could see us getting into next March and going, oh, perhaps.
What if we do this? What if we ask Shannon to take a look at the committees and make a recommendation to us about when and how many and which ones ought to be invited to meetings?
That's a good idea.
Okay?
I like that.
Okay. Anything else before we move on to pay orders?
Yes.
Yes, ma'am.
I would like to announce to the public that we have an animal clinic, both cats and dogs, March 8th, this Saturday at Newburgh Fire Department from 10 to 1. Line up as you come in. I will be there to be able to license your dogs. If you don't have to get inoculations, you can come and find me and get your tag on Saturday. So that's 10 to 1. And I would also invite anybody who was at the town meeting, particularly the Board of Civil Authority, within about 3 more days, I should have the first draft of the town minutes ready, and you're welcome to come in. If you want me to email them so that you can look at them, that would be fine. I will be asking at least 2 Board of Civil Authority members to approve them, but everybody's welcome.
Sounds good. Thank you kindly.
You're welcome.
Anything else that any of the members of the board have before we move on to pay orders?
No, but I have something.
Yes, ma'am.
The Planning Commission has invited the Select Board, or the prior Select Board, to the next meeting on the 10th.
Next
meeting. For about a half an hour to discuss the town plan.
Is that here?
Yes, but you're a new board now, so.
So we have to agree to it again?
Yeah, you don't need a motion, but
pardon?
Some or all of you could go.
Did they expect all of us, or
did they
expect some of us?
They would like all.
They expected all of them, the zoning administrator, and the all of us.
Are you guys okay with attending that meeting on the 10th? Everybody wants to make it?
7.
I'll tell you about the 10th.
It starts at 7
p.m.
Here?
And here.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's the Planning Commission. Okay, it sounds to me like the board is still okay with that. So.
Yes.
Okay.
Have you confirmation from Merle that he can be here?
Tristram is inviting who he needs to invite, and I'm taking care of the Select Board.
Okay. Sounds good. Anybody else from the board have anything they want to share with the board? Well, let me thank you very kindly for being here tonight and offering the thoughts and perspectives that you did. It can only be helpful to the board to hear from you guys. So you're going to be thinking of things that don't occur to one or another of us, and that's great. So thank you very much for being here. You're welcome to stay here if you're
able to pay for it. Now, have we ever had clapping at the end of a board meeting?
Gary, it's a pleasure to have you back here.
Thank you, Frank. I'll let you know in a while if it's a pleasure to be here.
Yeah, you should have paper.